Good evening to one and all. Yeah, thank you again, Saurabh, for the great introduction and also about my family also and my kids. And it was very aesthetic. Thank you so much. So how we got into Blend Global is something like I had my father's friend, Dr. Lakshmi Narayanan, who introduced me to Blend Global. Every interaction that we made was just over phone, and the team made it very easy that it was a cakewalk for me really to just get into the show and then just do it. That's it. So today my topic would be on emotional intelligence. So why emotional intelligence is something which I wanted to share. So hope everyone is doing very great at home, staying safe and staying at home. But what happened is, initially, when the lockdown was imposed, we were all very good. Okay, we all enjoyed the lockdown, that we had time with our family, everything. But as months and days passed and as the lockdown extended, we were all feeling a bit crippled. Yes or no? So when we were feeling crippled, I thought, yeah, something is wrong. What is it? We were able to see that our emotions are running high now and then. Every time our emotions are like that ECG, which is going up and coming down. So we are not able to control just because we are inside the four walls. So then I thought, okay, probably this is the topic which I have to share. And as a trainer, I have been in the training industry for the past 4 years. And my way of training is not sitting and training. It is not my way of training. My training would be always on a game oriented thing. So this is my first virtual class, but still I think I could make the best out of it. And today let's go to the session, which is nothing but emotional intelligence. And after this session, we will be seeing how to handle our emotions and how to take away and how to really work with it. Yes. So, Saurabh, can I do the slide share now? Screen share? Yeah. So, this is the definition, clinical definition of an emotion. So emotions are a part of human nature, which gives us information about what we are experiencing because of any circumstance, mood, or relationship. Okay. But how many of us really know what our emotions are? Some people really cry. Okay. When we cry, we usually say that they are sad. But is it really so? Is it really that when we cry, we are sad? No, not actually, right? It is because we cry when we are feeling happy also, when we are feeling stressed, when we are lonely, when we are frustrated, when we are angry. No, there are so many things which can be pointed upon. But the emotion which we show is only crying, right? So we cannot name an emotion just by the name and say that, okay, crying means it is sad. No, not at all. So we know what are all the emotions, but can we really name some of them? Can I have some of the emotions from you, the participants? Emotions? Yes, what are all the emotions? Can I have some?
Smiling.
Smiling, yes.
Hello.
Shouting.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, shouting. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah.
Smiling.
Happiness.
Happiness. Yeah, very few. Yeah, that is what we know. Yes. Anger, yes. The most important. No?
Excitement.
Yes.
Excitement, fear.
Yes. So we know these are some of the emotions, okay? But whether we know we are experiencing that, so that we will say it today. So today, what is literally an emotion is nothing but emotion, that is to move. Okay, to move where? That is the question, right? So we will see where to move. To move within ourselves, with ourselves, with others, and within others. This is my definition of emotions. Only four things. What is it? It is within ourselves, with others, and within others. So these are the four things which we will be seeing today as related to emotional intelligence. Yes? Okay. So any human being or any personality of a human being is made up of two things which we all know, which is nothing but the intelligence quotient and the emotional quotient. Okay. This intelligent quotient is something which is there within us from birth. Okay. We have been given it through education, culture. So all this intelligent quotient and through our genes. So it all comes with us. Then how about emotional quotient? Yeah. It is also there within us, which makes our personality. So how important is this emotional quotient? I'll tell you. See, intelligence is important. I don't say no, but the intelligence will get you to a job. But what will get you promoted is nothing but your emotional quotient and your emotional intelligence, right? So when you get into a job, you get into it as a new person with your intelligence, you just go in. But in today's world, we have to start interacting with people very nicely so that you get to know what is really happening in the office or at your workplace or whatever. So this emotional quotient plays a very, very, very important role. Yes. Yeah. See, this intelligent quotient is nothing but the crystallized or the accumulated knowledge which has been coming up till the age of 15 or 18, which your parents give you, which your surroundings give you, which your education give you. Yeah. And this fluid intelligence is nothing but the problem-solving skills. Okay. So now if we all take up a differential calculus problem and when they ask us to solve, can we really do it? No, really not. Okay. So what we do is, though you have got 100 in maths, probably when you were in school, now if I ask you to do a differential calculus problem, it'll take a minute or two for us to really gather up what it was and then put it on paper. So that is emotional quotient. Yeah. I mean, intelligence quotient. What is emotional quotient? It is nothing but reading and understanding the emotions. Yeah. Reading and understanding the emotions of self and also of others. Okay. So intelligent quotient tells you how smart you are. Okay. And the emotional quotient tells you how well you can use your smartness in every field and every situation where you can be. Intelligent quotient, as Saurav said, it can be measured through some tests. Okay. But emotional quotients, no. We cannot measure it as of now. We haven't got any tool as of now clinically to really measure the emotional quotient. Yes. Okay. So any idea as to who is this person? Anyone? No? No? Yeah. So he is a different person, no? So
Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi.
No, he is not Mahatma Gandhi, no. He is Phineas Gage, okay. This is called as the American crowbar case, okay. It is very interesting. This person was born in 1823 in the US and he was a railway foreman worker. So initially when railways were started, what happened was, the boulders and all, we don't have machines at that time to just lift the boulders and put it down or drill through the rocks. So what happened, this foreman, he was a foreman, railway foreman, and he was a very good worker in the sense he used to mingle with people very well and he is known for his work and his intelligence. So what happened at one point of time when he was trying to break the rock with that bomb, right? The bomb just fused off and the iron rod poked through his skull. Okay. And his frontal left lobe of the brain was damaged and it came out through the other end. So you can see here, this is how it was. And he was so lucky that he survived this incident and he lived after this for about 12 years. okay, with normal life, leading a normal life, just he lost his one eye, the sight of one eye. That is the only thing that was the difference. So, but then after a treatment of 2 or 3 years, he again went back to this home and work, but the government was not ready to sanction because of his physical appearance and his, because he got hurt, okay? So he was deployed into another section. But what happened is, as time passed by, people were able to note the difference in his behavior. His behavior changed a lot. What happened was, how nice he used to be. His friends used to tell everyone he was a very nice person to mingle with. But now he has started showing his frustration and he started behaving very badly in public without knowing what is happening around him and everything. So what happened? People started that, okay, something has gone wrong because he is hurt in his brain. But what really happened was known only after 80 years. What is it this? Yeah. Actually, what happens in the brain for the emotions? Because how these emotions work, that I'll let you know. When a signal is given, it passes through our spinal cord and the brain, and it goes to the limbic system, which is nothing but the frontal lobe of the brain, which makes you take a rational decision in life. Yes? Now, this rod has pierced through the place of the frontal lobe of this limbic system, where this, the signals that will go to the brain to take the rational decision was cut off. This no one didn't notice, because no one ever knew about all this anatomy at that point of time. So then they realized, yes, this frontal lobe and the brain has got some connection to do with the emotions. Yes. So this emotions is nothing but everything which is stored in the brain, but gets activated only when you feel from within. So that is the basic point. When you start feeling from within, this limbic system will give a flash of that signal to the rational brain, which will help you think rationally. Yes? Yeah. So we all have this intelligent child, right? We all want to have an intelligent child, and we all had that. Today, in today's world, every child is intelligent. No doubt on it. Whatever you do, wherever they go, they shine in their own field. Yes? But the children who got 10th and 12th first mark, okay, first mark in 10th and 12th, where do you think they are? Yeah? They are working in a very big multinational company. Yes? And you can see the people who got an average of around 80 or 85 or something, they are working as CEOs of that company. Yeah, that is the reality now. You can take in the example of Mr. Sundar Pichai. Yeah, his 12th marks is around 80% only. Yeah. I don't say that people who get very good marks, like in 10th or 12th, don't shine, but how they use it makes the difference. Yeah. So we all should bring up a child not only who is intelligent, but also who is emotionally intelligent. Because children now, they can understand and feel the emotions at every point. So now it is in our hands to make them realize what really it is. And in their upbringing also, this emotional intelligence has to be included, which we as trainers can definitely do. Yes? Yeah. So for this, we have an example of this impulse test, which is nothing but the marshmallow test. Many of you would know this, but still, I just want to throw some light on it, which is nothing, but these are all called the marshmallows, right? It is very famous. These marshmallows, these psychologists wanted to take a test on the behavioral pattern changes that happened in children when they were young and when they were in the adolescence and when they grew big. So initially, what happened, they chose five children, of age 4 years, and they let into a room which was having a bowl full of marshmallows. So marshmallows are like sweet candies, as we all know. So when these 4 year children were just let into the room, they were given one condition. I will give you one marshmallow now, And after you enter the room, you have to sit and wait there patiently. Then there is a person outside who will come in again and give you the second marshmallow. Yeah. So there were children who were able to wait for the other person to come in, and there were children who were not able to wait because they are so small. Obviously, they would be tempted to eat the marshmallows, right? So they just went and they started eating. So these children were then categorized as people who ate the marshmallows and children who did not eat. So after that, these children were again reviewed after 14 years during their adolescence. So at that time, this was the result. Okay, the children who resisted the temptation, they were more socially competent and they were personally effective, self-assertive. They know that what they are doing is correct or wrong. They were very much self-assertive and they were able to cope up with stress very easily. They were not pressurized at all. Yeah, this cope up with stress very easily. Then the people who gave in for the temptation, right, the children, they were disorganized. They were not able to handle themselves. Yeah, and they had a more troubled, you know, situations. They were not able to handle that, and they were very stubborn. They were very stubborn in getting things done. Okay, we have seen people like that who are very stubborn in getting things done. We have seen people at workplace, yeah, they say, yeah, I want this work to be done just now, right? We have seen people like that. So this is the small thing that they have done. So what they found out from the emotional part of it is that when they gave in for the temptation, when they were not able to resist the emotion, these were the effects in the future. When they were able to hold back their emotions, control their emotions, okay, resisted the temptation, they were personally very much effective than the other. Yes? Now, why do we need emotional intelligence? I'm talking about the history, what happened, why. Now I'm going to say why it is required at today's world, okay, why it is required. So for these many years, probably till the 90s, we were not speaking about emotional intelligence. We didn't know that there was something called as emotional quotient and we have to work on it. No, never. When my dad was working or something, he never knew that there was something called as emotional quotient. Yeah. But now people know that there is something called as emotional intelligence and emotional quotient. So why? So initially, when you get into a workplace, we enter in as dependent. So we depend on someone to get our work done. Okay. So after 6 months or 1 year of probation, we are independent. We know how to do our job. Okay. This was the thing which was happening before 10 years. But now you have to work only when you are interdependent. You cannot work individually at a workplace. Yeah. So you are interdependent on someone, not only at workplace, even at home, even at a social gathering, wherever you go, we are interdependent as human beings. So what is most required? It is skill, knowledge, or talent that we will see. See, when there is an example of an injection, okay? Anyone can give an injection? No, we cannot do it. There are certain certified people who give injections. So that is the skill. And people know, the doctors know how much of the medicine should be taken into the syringe. Okay, that is the knowledge. And certain doctors or the nurses know how to give the injection without any pain. Yes or no? So that is called as talent. Today people look for talent. Though you have the skill, though you have the knowledge, you should have the talent to really give the painless injection to the person. You should really have the talent to really tell what you are feeling to other person and to understand about others. Yes. So this talent, we will just, you know, scrape it up today. Yeah. These are the four pillars or four core skills of emotional intelligence. To the topic exactly, the first one is self-awareness. The second one is self-management. Third one is social awareness. And the last but not the least, which is much required, is the relationship management. Yes? So first, we will go into self-awareness. Okay? Understanding your own emotions. We all know we are feeling bad, we are feeling sad. Okay? Everything, we are able to feel it. But do we really, can we really correlate it to the names which we are giving to the emotions? Not really. Not always, actually. So, then you have to start evaluating the emotions. For example, I cry when I'm angry. I don't cry when I'm sad or feeling bad. Okay? I cry when I'm angry. So, I have to relate my crying to anger, my crying to frustration, not my crying to sadness. So, you have to know to correlate your emotions and feelings and what is running within you. So, what self-awareness really means is, how do you understand your own characters, feelings, motives and desires? What do you want in life from you? Okay, how do you rate yourself? That is your self-awareness. Okay. Okay. So, expressions and emotional contagion. So, while you are with a person who is very happy and who is laughing, okay, laughing continuously. You have seen in parks, right, this laughter therapy which they do. So, it is very contagious. Though you just pass by, you start laughing. Yes or no? So, these expressions and emotions are really contagious. So, you have seen, I will give you an example of the Vietnam War. We all know about the Vietnam War which was happening between the Americans and the Vietnamese. So, amidst the war which was happening between the borders, this side and that side, it was a huge war. We all know that. So what happened was, there were six monks who just walked in between on the border road. So what happened was, the war abruptly stopped for 5 minutes. This was told by a soldier from the US who had fought in the war. So we didn't know, the monks didn't speak anything. The monks didn't say anything. They didn't even look at these people. They were just walking through the path. So, their emotion of peace was so contagious that the war stopped at that moment. This way, the emotions can be contagious even with us. Okay? But the way do we express, right, that differs from person to person. Or rather say, people at different parts of the world. For example, in Japan, they don't express so much. They will minimize their emotions. You can see them, right? They always bow and they always just show your respect, thankfulness, everything they show that way, okay? They don't show their anger, not much, right? So they have this minimizing of expressions and emotions, and exaggerating. Exaggerating comes to artists, okay? Like in movies and artists over stage. So all these people exaggerate so that they can express the emotion and it reaches the audience very well. Then substituting. For this, I have a good example, okay? So, for example, say your couple is fighting at home, okay? They are at the highest of their peak of their emotions. They are shouting and they are fighting like anything, okay? Then you have an unattended guest, okay? Uninvited guest who is coming home and ringing the bell with a small child. So, what we will do? Our emotions will immediately change. Immediately change, and we will say, yeah, 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 please welcome, and we will seem to handle our emotions so well, so that the other person will not know, the guest will not know that there is something bad that is happening here. Though the environment of the room will show, but still we try to manage our emotions, right? So this is substituting of emotions, okay? Okay, now we'll all, much of talking, so now we will all go into a small activity. What I would do is, I want to capitalize on the thing that I am a dancer, okay? So what I will do is, I will start showing emotions on my face, okay? And I want each one of you to really identify and tell me what emotion it is, okay? I will express it on my face. I want you to find out and let me know what it is, okay? Shall we all start? Yes? Okay, so Saurav, can you unmute everyone?
Yeah.
Yes, okay.
Put the emotion on the chat box also.
Yeah, they can do that also. Yeah, We'll go for it. Yes, the first one. Okay.
Surprise.
Yeah, exactly. It is surprise. Okay. Then second one.
Accomplishment.
Yes.
Accomplishment.
Accomplishment.
Happy.
Happy. We call it hasya, that is laughter. Yes. When you do accomplishment or when you feel happy. Yes. Then the third one. Okay.
Challenge.
Yes. Courage. Yes.
Proud.
We call it veera. Veera in dance. Okay. The next one.
Contented. Peace.
No. That is
meditation.
Yeah, meditation. What do you get? While you meditate?
Bhakti.
Mental peace.
Peace. Shanta. Yes? Okay. The next one.
Overwhelmed.
Yes.
Overwhelmed.
Yeah, it is compassion. Karuna. Karuna. Compassion. Okay. Next is
shine.
Blushing. Shyness.
Shine. Love. It is called blushing. Shringara. Okay.
Blushing.
Next one.
Fear.
Yes.
Fear.
It is Bhayanatha. Yes. The next one.
Hate. Girna.
Yes.
Hate.
Disgust. Okay. You are not feeling that feeling. Okay. So it is called as Vibhishta. Yeah.
Vibhish.
Yeah. Next one. The most important one, which everyone will have.
Anger.
Angry.
Yes, anger. Exactly. Raudra. Okay. We call it as the anger. Okay. The most thing which we are not able to really handle is this anger. Yes or no? Because this anger is an emotion which gets triggered just in a second. Okay, and we don't know really how to handle this anger. Okay, so I'll just throw light on only this thing, which is anger. Yeah, because I felt it is the most important thing which everyone should know how to handle it. Okay, so we cannot let our anger loose, and we should explain it. Yeah, when I say it is very easy, when I say that you have to explain your anger, it is very easy. But it doesn't happen at that moment. It doesn't happen at that moment. We cannot hold back our anger for a longer period of time. Yes? And we cannot, so for on a jolly note, right? We cannot correct our spouses in the same way as we correct our children. Yes or no? If we do it, what will happen? Either the roof will come down or the wife will be on the roof. Yes or no? Both are right. Okay. So, this thing of anger which was told by Aristotle is anybody can become angry. Yeah, that is very easy. But to be angry with the right person, to the right level, at the right time, and for the right purpose and in the right way is very important. Yes or no? Because we get anger, because that button of anger is really always the first button which is there in our body, which anyone can just prick it and switch it off. Yeah, they can just touch the button and we'll get activated. Yes. So this anger, you have to really understand what it is going on and why you are getting this anger. It will take some time. Definitely it will take some time. So, but then you have to just master it and show that why you should not let your anger loose. We have to show anger whenever it is required, but not always. Okay. Yeah. Now, first thing is that quit treating your feelings as good or bad. There is no bad feeling. There's nothing called as bad feeling. Every feeling is good. Okay. But how you handle it or express it makes it good or bad. Yes. So quit treating your feelings as good or bad. Don't name your feelings as good or bad. Treat them with the name which you want to give it and handle them, whether it is going to create any good to you or others, or it is going to create anything bad to you or others. Okay. That is the ripple effect. What do we mean by the ripple effect? For example, as I said, the emotions are contagious. So for example, you are in a meeting room, okay? So, and you don't like a co-worker who is just sitting there. So when you are starting to give an explanation about your own project in the meeting room, you might target that person and say, this person was not helping me, without even really knowing that, without mentioning his name. Okay, we will say, okay, without anyone's help, without this, I did it. Okay, the person might know it, even the room, even the person, other people in the room might know it. This will cause a ripple effect of this bad feeling that you have for that person to pass it on to others, which is not required at all. So don't cause that ripple effect in a social place. Yes, feel your emotions physically. Okay, so as I am a dancer, before I get onto the stage, I would be able to feel my legs are shivering. Physically, I will be able to feel, and many of us would really feel that butterflies are flying in our stomach. Okay, we physically feel that when we are nervous. Yes, so all these things you feel it physically. What is happening to your body when you have a certain emotion? When you are feeling hungry, what is happening? When you are feeling frustrated, what is happening to your body? You can really feel it. Just start feeling your emotions physically. Know who and what pushes your buttons. That is what I said. Okay. The best people who push your buttons on emotions are the closest people who you are with. It might be your father, mother, your spouse, or your children. And the best people are the children. Yeah, they know what, which button to be pushed to their moms and dads so that the sibling will get, you know, the scolding. We have all seen it, okay? When we tell this, my mom will get angry and she will scold my sister. The children know it, okay? So the same way, we know that people around us, when they know us very close, when they are very close to us, they know when we push that button, they will get triggered. Don't allow the person to trigger the button. And even if they trigger it, know how to handle it. Okay. See, anyone can push the button. Okay. But the circuit is within us to whether to react to that button or not to react to it. Yeah. And don't be fooled by bad mood and a good mood. Okay. So when you are in a bad mood or when you are in a good mood, we always know, please don't take any decisions. When you take decisions in a bad mood or a good mood, either of them will not work. Yeah. So please don't be fooled by a bad mood or a good mood. Calm yourself to a great mood, I would say. Okay, then you take a decision on what you have to do and plan it. Okay. Next is self-management. Okay. Skills that allow you to control and manage your own emotions. Okay. How to manage self in different situations and meet the situation suitable to you. So that is the main thing which we want to do. The situations cannot be changed, but it can be made suitable how you want to react and respond to that situation. So that is your self-management skill. Okay. So we will see what are all the character strengths that a human being can have. These are the 24 characteristics which every human being will have. the creativity, curiosity, judgment, perspective, bravery, love, everything we all have within us. Yes or no? We call it as the 24 character strengths of any human being, normal human being. But what we do not have is whether we are using it at the right levels every day. Yes? So we all have this, but are we using it every day? No. So we can use it in a small way, which we call it as the 2:2:2 ratio. What I found out by doing this is you can just use two of your character strengths, okay, with two people, okay, for 2 days. So use two of these character strengths with two people for 2 days. That is what we call it as 2:2:2. So when you start showing this kindness or love or humor, gratitude, whatever, you start showing it, what will happen is our brain and our emotions will get relearned. Okay, it will be relearned. Our emotions are relearned. So once you relearn your emotions, it is very easy for us to manage them. Yes or no? So this is the thing which I would say 2:2:2. Use two of your character strengths for 2 days with two people. Definitely you will see a change in how you manage your emotions. Okay. So these are all the strategies. Okay. First thing is breathe right. What is this breathing has got to do with self-management? Yes, right? That is a question which everyone will have in your face. The first thing is that we have to know what is happening. How do you manage your own body within yourself? We all know our body is like a balloon. Okay. So once you breathe in, the balloon should go out. Once you breathe out, the balloon should flatten. But when we breathe in, what is happening? We expand our stomach. And when we have to actually expand our stomach. And when we breathe out, we have to contract. But what we are doing it the reverse way. Yes or no? Knowingly or unknowingly, we are doing it. But it is high time that we start concentrating on this. What will happen is, when you start concentrating on this, this oxygen level which is pumped to the brain is so high that you will start realizing what is really happening to you physically, which will help you discover your emotions easily after a period of time. Okay. Then the second one, create an emotions versus reasons list. What emotions you are feeling and why you are feeling it. What emotions you are feeling now when you are angry or when you're crying, what is happening to you? Form a reasons list. Whether it is rational or irrational, just decide on that. Okay? Next is visualization. Visualization is, we all know that, right? For the thought which we have for the future, that is visualization. Okay? A small example was done. What is it? Is there were a group of people who were made to sit in a room and a group of people who were taken to a sunset point. Okay. These people in the room were made to close their eyes and they were given the temperature and the surroundings as same as it would be outside at the sunset point. And they were asked to close their eyes and they were asked to visualize the sunset, and there was a person who was giving how the sun is rising, how the birds are flying, everything. So what they found out was the same part of the brain for both the groups were activated. That is, the people who were there in the room and the people who were viewing the sunset, they both had the same visualization, same emotions being triggered, same part of the brain being activated. So visualization has got such a power. So for me, today I thought my session is going to be terrific. Okay. And I'm halfway through it and I know it is good. It is great. So this visualization technique, which will really help you to visualize what is going to happen, the good things that will happen to you in the future. Next is staying synchronized. Because when you manage yourself well, you can manage others well. That is a very simple logic which we all know. Stay synchronized. Yes. Staying synchronized, which you plan and you execute. Anything with planning and execution will never fail. At times, yes, we do have a backup plan, but that plan also should be ready with you. stay synchronized with whatever things you do. Give it a time, give it a preparation, and stay synchronized in life too. Okay, now next, we'll go for this visualization. I have certain slides. I want to see whether my visualization is same as yours. Okay, this is an example which you are seeing on the screen. I want you all to find out what it is. I'll give you a clue. It is a place. It is a place. Yes. Yes. It is a place. Can anyone tell me? Saurav, if you could unmute. It is a place. Anyone?
Lotus pond.
Lotus pond. No. Next. You have to connect all the three images and give me an answer.
Pondicherry.
Ah, great. Yeah, it is Pondicherry. So my visualization and my emotions have gone with someone. Yeah, Saurav. Is it Saurav? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Now the next one. Okay. It is Pondicherry. It is Pondicherry. Yes. The next one. Yes. This is a thing which will comfort you. Which will comfort you. Yes.
Thank you very much.
It will comfort you. That is the clue.
Tablet.
Tablet. No. Tablets don't comfort us. It will still create problems. No. Which will comfort you. Yeah?
It is pillow.
Pillow. Yes, exactly. It is pillow. It is pillow. Great. I have like-minded people here. No? Okay, this one. It is closely related to the topic which we are talking today. Now. Yes.
Understand.
Very closely related.
Understand.
Yes, yes. Understanding. Understanding.
Yes.
Understanding twice. Yes, it is understanding twice. Okay, that is what we have to do with our emotions. Try to understand it twice before you react or respond. Yes. Okay, this is a small exercise which
to,
I thought.
To understand.
Yeah. It is understanding twice. Okay. Okay. Then we come to the third pillar, which is nothing but the social awareness. Social awareness is much more important in today's world because we are socially connected everywhere. Each and every person is socially connected. Without it, at least this period of lockdown, we are definitely socially connected. Without it, we cannot help it. Okay. So what is social awareness? Being socially sensitive, able to recognize others' emotions. That is social awareness. See, when you are with a person and you are able to understand their emotions when they are speaking to you, they feel much more closer to you. Yes or no? So we select friends like that, right? Your best friend will be the person who understands your emotions. Yes. Then social communication, understanding of the social and ethical norms. You cannot speak whatever you like to speak in a public gathering, right? You have to have control of the words and how you speak and where you speak and what you speak. Then social insight, being aware of what and who is around you. That's what I said. Then organizational awareness. When you work in an organization, they have certain culture and norms with that you have to follow. Though you might be from a different background, you have to really literally follow it when you have to work in a group. I have a small example for this. Okay? What happens is, I went to Thailand. Okay, so I'm fond of all of us are fond of small babies, right? So when I tried to lift a small baby, the mother was okay. Then we all have this habit of blessing the child on the head, right? We bless them on the head and then we give Ashirvad. That is Indian culture, okay? So when I was in Thailand, and when I just had the baby, and just, when I put him back, I just blessed him like this, and then I came. The mom became very ferocious. She was very ferocious. She started scolding me something in their own language, which I didn't understand, but I knew that she was angry. I didn't know. Okay. But then what happened was, then I realized in Japanese and Thailand, you know, that Buddhist culture, what it is they respect that this is the highest part of the human being and your soul rests on the head. So you cannot touch anyone else's head without their permission, and only parents are allowed to touch their children's head, not an outsider. But what we do in India, whoever comes to us and just takes ashirvad, we bless them on their head. So this is what, this is a small thing of social awareness which you have to know when you go to places, when you travel to places, or when you work in a social environment. These are all small things which we have to take care of. Okay. So next, coming to the most important point, which is nothing but empathy. Empathy is nothing but the ability to hear and understand accurately the unspoken or partly expressed thoughts and feelings and concerns of others. Okay. So we say that, no, what is empathy? Literally is that putting yourself in the other person's shoe. That is empathy. You will understand the you will literally understand the emotions of that person. When you try to understand the emotions of that person, you will be able to literally, you know, go through their feelings. Okay. So in empathy, we have three types of empathies. Okay. So what is it? The first one is nothing but we have this called as cognitive empathy. Cognitive empathy is that you understand the other person's empathy. You have this feeling, the other person's feeling, you are able to just name it and you are able to understand, you are able to listen to that person. That is cognitive empathy, which is much required as in a negotiation skill. That is cognitive empathy. Then next comes the emotional empathy. What is emotional empathy? You start feeling with that person. Okay. When a close friend of you comes to you and say, I'm feeling very bad, I'm feeling very sad, and he's crying, without our knowledge, we will start crying. Yes or no? That is emotional empathy. Next is compassionate empathy. That is more than the emotional empathy, you get into action. Okay. When someone is hurt on the road, okay, you get into the action, you lift that person, and we first initially what we do, we say, we pity on them. Okay. Oh boy, it's so bad that they got hurt. Yeah, that is empathy. Okay. Second one is that when a small child is crying, you start crying with them. So for example, when parents go for an injection for a child to a doctor, when the doctor is going to give the injection only to the child, but what will happen? This father and mother will say, and all that, right? They start reacting. That is emotional empathy. Then what is this compassionate empathy? When a person is hurt, you lift the person, take him to the doctor, you just spring into action. That is emotional empathy, which is much required in today's world. This compassionate empathy is something which you have to start showing to people. Emotional empathy is trying to feel. Yeah, you have to feel the pain. Then only you can understand their feeling. Yes. So please try to start being empathetic. Yeah, we are empathetic, but we don't show it. That is the problem. Yeah. Next is social awareness strategy. Yeah, greet people by name. So you, when you start, you know, greeting people by name, they feel very good. No, any person called by name, they are feeling very good. Then the art of listening. We all have seen a lot about listening. Okay. Give in yourself when you are listening. Have empathy. Live as the character. Okay. This is what something we as artists have learned. You should live as the character. You should emote as the character to know how socially you are aware and catch the mood of the room before you speak something. Okay. Know who is around you before you speak. Okay? Then reference points. This is something which is very important in social awareness. What is it is? When we are socially connected, we knowingly or unknowingly start comparing ourselves with people. Yeah, this is, it is a known fact. We start really comparing people with ourselves. Oh, this person is looking very good. This person's training is so great. Will I be able to do? No, I have to go to that level. Yeah, it is good up till some extent. Okay. See, for example, when you had a, you know, when you got money from your job for 20,000, you said, no, no, next, my aim should be I have to get 50,000. Now, when your income is 50,000, what will your brain, your reference point will change. It will say, no, no, it is 1 lakh. So reference points keep changing because of our brains. Okay. See, for example, when you are in a place, you are unemployed, you have lost the job. Okay. So you have lost the job. And when you have, you are in a place where the other people around you have very good job and very good salaries, what will happen? You feel the pain because your reference point are your neighbors and friends and relatives who are there for working and earning. But now in this situation, probably at many parts of the world, there are so many people who are unemployed. Okay. So you don't feel really bad that you are not employed. You say, okay, this is a situation. Our reference point has changed. This is a situation. It will improve. So you don't feel bad that you are unemployed when the people around you are also not employed. Yes or no? So this is the reference point. So it is very important that where and how you set your reference point. Reframe and reset your reference point for you and not for others. Yes. Next, the last pillar is nothing but the relationship management. The most important thing, okay? The ability to get the best out of others is through your relationship. How well you behave, respond, and react to people builds the relationship over years. There are so many bankers here now. You all know how to do the relationship management because I learned it from the banker, my dad. So there are so many things which you have to really know about being in a relationship because that is something which, you know, really matters a lot. See, you can be in a relationship, but how do you manage and continue for so much time and over the years is a big question mark. Okay? Talk and listen to any person thinking that he or she is the most important person in your life. Yeah? When you have this idea in your brain, your relationship will never break. Yeah? So, because nowadays what we are doing, we are having the gadget in our hand and when someone is talking, we are looking at say, yes. Yes. We don't really listen to that person, do we? Not at times. Consciously, when we try to listen to that person, your relationship doubles and triples. Okay? So, what are the strategies that we can use? Be open and curious. Whatever you want to say, say it directly. Yeah, say it directly. Then take the feedback well. Though they say, no, they criticize you so bad, take it as a positive criticism. Oh, probably my view of telling this thing was wrong. He didn't like it. How can I correct it? Take the feedback as a positive criticism. Build trust. That is the most important thing in a relationship. When you don't build the trust, whatever you say, it's not going to have a point. Yeah. Next is when you care, show it. We all care. Okay. We all care. But do we really express it when you care? So we have our spouses at home. We have our children at home. But do we really show? We care. They all know that we care. But show it physically. Tell them. Tell them that you care for them. You care for everyone and every relationship. You value it. Okay. Yes. Next is, you all know, right? Mutual funds and relationships are the same. You have to invest. So I say you have to care. Only when you care, you will get the reciprocative care for you also. Okay. You must invest before you withdraw. When you expect something, you have to do it first. Okay. Then the forgiveness, the most underestimated quality in a relationship. Okay. So what we do is when someone gets hurt, even when we are going in a bus, you stamp on a leg. What do you say? I'm sorry. Yeah. Do we really mean it? No, not at all. We say, because you have stamped, you say, I'm sorry. No, but really you should say a sorry from the bottom of your heart. Feel it and say a sorry. Then the person who is standing there will really forgive you. Okay? And in this forgiveness, there is one tagline. When you have decided to ask sorry, ask it immediately. Don't wait for a day or two. Okay? That happens, that too with our very close friends or relatives. Okay? We know that we have done a mistake, but we have this ego of not asking the sorry on that day. Let it go to the next day. Okay? Next day, we think that it will be normalized. Okay? We start talking, everything will be there. But still, what is the most important thing is, when you don't ask a sorry, when that person has not forgiven you, that thought will be there at the back of the brain, running behind you. Yeah? It will be there in their brain. It will not be erased. So when you ask the sorry, ask it immediately and from the bottom of the heart. And when you are at the position of forgiving someone, forgive it totally. Don't ever, you know, recall the past of the person who has done the mistake. You did it on that day. No, don't ever remind of it. You have forgiven. That's it. You don't have to recall the same or the past. Don't do that. Okay? Then, now, the problem. Yeah? When someone says, it is my problem, what does he mean? It means that, yeah, he is at guilt. I am guilty. It means it's my problem. Okay? Whether they tell it with anger, whether they tell it with frustration, whatever it is, it means that they are guilty. Next is, it is your problem. What does it mean? You are at fault. You are at fault. I have nothing to do with it. It means it is your problem. Now, people have to find out what is the problem. It is the problem. If you find out the problem, then you have a solution. So please try to find out the problem. Don't do it in a relationship. Name it as your problem or my problem. Just define it as the problem. Okay? Then, when someone says, thank you, how do we respond? The first thing is that we say, welcome. Okay? Then we say, no problem. Okay? So, what does it mean is, thank you. When you say thank you, welcome, what does it mean? Welcome means, yeah, anytime again you can come back to me. No problem, what does it mean? We have started using these words. So in a relationship, that is why I'm able to say, when someone says thank you, we say, yeah, yeah, no problem. What does it mean? It was not a big deal for me for doing it for you. It was not a big deal. It shows your attitude. So don't ever say no problem when someone says thank you. And when you say, when someone says thank you, what is the best way to answer? It is my pleasure. Yeah, it is from the gratitude that you feel from within and you say, it is my pleasure of helping you. God has given me this time to help you. So I'm very grateful for it. This one word of saying, it is my pleasure from the bottom of your heart, will really build your relationship. Yes? There. So this is the gist of what we have seen now. Yeah? Just for a second, for a review. Okay. Now I want to just tell a small story on 7 pounds and 10 shillings. Many of you would have known this story, but still a quick recap. Okay. There was a doctor who was traveling on the ship from America to London. And the ship travel, cruise travel will take 4 days. Okay. And he never wanted to reveal that he was a doctor to anyone. Why? Because when you notify that you are a doctor, whether you have a problem or you don't have a problem, we go and tell them, doctor, I wanted to consult this with you because you are a doctor. I have this problem. I think I have a headache. I think I have a sinus. How can we treat it? You don't have this. You don't have this. It's human nature. So this doctor decided, no, I'll never tell that I'm a doctor. I want to have a peaceful journey. Then he decided, and he was about 60 years old. So he was traveling on the cruise, and there was one couple who came on the first day who was looking at this doctor continuously. Then he didn't respond. The doctor didn't respond. Then the second day also, these couple were discussing something on seeing the doctor, discussing something. And on the third day, this wife, what she did, she literally pushed the husband and said, go and talk. Okay. So this person, he came and he sat beside the doctor and he said, sir, doctor, do you remember me? This doctor was asked, I mean, like, he was taken aback. I never said I was a doctor. How did he know? So he said, no, I don't remember you. Doctor just recalled before 30 years. Okay. Still I don't remember you. Okay. Then he mentioned the date. Okay. Just recall on February 22nd night. Okay. And a small boy. Now this doctor flashed in his brain. This doctor remembered. What it was, it was the night on February 22nd. It was about 11 o'clock in the US. What happened was, this doctor was a very young doctor who has finished his practice and he is into practicing now. So anytime they come as a constable or a person or to treat, so you have to respond to that person. So there was a constable at this doctor's house knocking on the door. He said at night 11 o'clock there was no power and it was raining very badly. And this sergeant came and he knocked on the door and he said, doctor, it's an emergency, you have to come. This doctor took his bag and he went to the place, which was pitch dark. Okay. So the sergeant showed through the torch and this doctor was able to see a small boy lying in a bed without any movement. Okay. So he knew that this boy's life was critical. So then he was able to smell the gas. This gas was nothing but then the doctor understood it is this boy has attempted for a suicide and this boy was a 17-year-old small boy. Okay. So then he gave he treated this boy. This boy revived and he was back into action. And there were three people in this room. There was a lady who was standing who was the house owner. And the second one is the sergeant, police sergeant. And the third one is the doctor and the small boy. So this small boy, when he opened his eyes, he thought, okay, my life is gone. Because this policeman will file a case, definitely a suicidal note, and my life is gone. So now this policeman said, boy, I'm not going to file a case against you. You tell me what happened. So he said, I work in a firm of my uncle where I just stole 7 pounds and 10 shillings. Now tomorrow morning when I go, I cannot face my uncle. So I felt very bad. So I attempted for the suicide. So now this policeman said, okay, fine. I will not file a case against you. Okay. Because I know your life will be shattered into pieces. This landlady also said, okay, I will also not give a complaint. Okay. Because I know this small boy from the past 3 or 4 years. So I know him. So I don't want to disturb his life. Then this doctor, what he did, he took out the 7 pounds and 10 shillings, the day's earning, and gave it to the boy. And he said, please replace the amount tomorrow morning in your uncle's office. So this boy replaced the amount on the next day. Okay. So this boy was the man, okay, was the husband who called him. Now the doctor recalled, oh, you are that man. So this boy or the man, the husband, he said, sir, I have, now what are you doing? It's great to see you. The doctor asked. So now this boy said, this man said, yes, I have now have a mansion which hosts children who come out from jail. Okay, prisoners who come out from jail. And I have a rehabilitation center for them. I run it as a mansion. Okay. So I'm repaying back to the police who saved me, to the landlord who saved me, but I was not able to find you. So how can I repay back? I don't know how to repay back to you. Right? So this person said, this doctor said, you are already repaying the same to me. What is it? Nothing but showing gratitude to so many people around you. That is my 7 pounds and 10 shillings. Okay? So always show gratitude to people. When you show gratitude, your emotions level will be so high. Your happiness quotient will increase. Okay, your emotions intelligence will be so great that you can perform very well. Yes. Now I'll end my session with a small sloka. Yato hastas tato drishti. Yato drishti tato manah. Yato manah tato bhava. Yato bhava tato rasah. So what does it mean? We have the sloka in Natya Shastra. The literal meaning is this, okay? Where your hands go, your eyes must follow. Where your eyes go, your mind must follow. Where your mind goes, your expressions should follow. And where the expressions go, the emotions will definitely follow. Yeah? So now, I wanted to put this into emotional intelligence. Have gratitude and peace. Show it through your hands. Okay? There are many eyes which are looking at you. Okay? It will get into the minds of other people and also your mind. Okay? And after that, when you express this gratitude and when you are emotionally intelligent, your emotions of happiness will flow like anything within you and also to others. Yes? That is my session on emotional intelligence. Thank you so much. Yes.